Good morning and welcome to the 11th meeting of 2017 of the Environment, Climate Change and Land Reform Committee. Before we move to the first item on the agenda, can I remind everyone present to ensure their mobile phones are on silent for the duration of the meeting. Can I also remind people that they shouldn't be taking photographs inside this committee room? The first item on the agenda is for the committee to consider whether to take items 5 and 6 in private. Are we all agreed? Are agreed. The second item on our agenda this morning is to take evidence on the review of the Protection of Wild Mammals Scotland Act 2002. We're joined this morning by the Right Honourable Lord Bonomy. Good morning.
Good morning, thank you.
Thank you for attending, Lord Bonomy. And we'll move direct to questions, if that's okay. Kate Forbes.
Thank you for being here. The review received a significantly high number of submissions, and I understand a lot of people were met in the course of the review. Can you comment on the strength of feeling amongst the public in terms of responding to this review, and also perhaps provide a brief summary of the views of those who responded?
Now, there's a big question. There were a fairly large number of people who were plainly opposed to hunting in principle, who voiced that opinion. There were a number of submissions which were one-liners, obviously individuals taking advantage of the opportunity just to voice a personal view, and no doubt a strongly held view. On the other side, there were many submissions which made assertions which clearly went beyond the personal knowledge of the individual. So someone who's a supporter of hunting might express the view that no one would do X or Y, this is just out of keeping with the traditions and so on. So in the end, it was difficult to make much of many of these submissions, but you could sense strong feelings on both sides of the argument. If anything, I suppose the pro-hunting lobby expressed their views more logically, with more factually based support. But that doesn't mean to say that their views were any, as far as I was concerned, that their views carried any more weight than those opposed to it. And I found it fairly easy to exclude from my mind the pro and anti-hunt lobby view, and to try to concentrate on what I could make of the submissions in the sense of actual factual findings. Now, I've made it clear there's a bit of speculation in what I've said, but so far as I could, I've based what I've said on submissions made, largely submissions made, but there was also, of course, some evidence gathering in other contexts as well, which provided factual material. I have to say it wasn't really within my brief to be gauging support or opposition, so I have got no way of supporting what I'm saying. I'm giving you merely an impression of how material came to me. It was divided into bundles of for and against, and those dealing with welfare and those dealing with other aspects when it was given to me, and probably the against, if you were just counting up the numbers, was higher than those four, but it didn't really have any bearing on what ultimately emerged.
Did you consider the remit of the review appropriate? Were there some aspects or views that you had to exclude because of the narrowness of the remit?
No, I think the remit was an appropriate one. That's not to say that I think that MSP's remit should be confined to that. That's an entirely different question. But I didn't find myself inhibited in any way from making a proper assessment of the issues given to me because of a narrow remit. The things that were excluded were, I think, quite properly excluded.
Thank you. Moving on, Emma.
Thank you. Good morning, Lord Bonomy. In the constituency that I represent, there was a fox killed by 10 hounds in the back garden. And so in the process of a mounted hunt, foxes are still being killed. So I'm wondering what measures would be put in place to eliminate this and what would be the best way to maybe separate the actual sport from pest control.
I came to broadly two conclusions at the end of the exercise. One was that the legislation needed a good looking at. Not that there may be a great deal wrong with it, but because it was a member's bill, it never really had the sort of scrutiny that most bills get from parliamentary draftsmen. And I have no doubt that this legislation would benefit from that. The other broad conclusion was that we need to find a way of being a bit more certain about what's going on, because it's an activity largely conducted away from the public eye. Those who engage in it have an interest in it and support it. And that's where the notion of monitoring came from. Now, in response to that, I had a number of sessions with individuals representing organisations concerned with animal welfare and those concerned with hunting. And the exchanges were remarkably frank. We also had very frank concessions from the Scottish Countryside Alliance on issues that the police might require to be disclosed around any hunting. And at one stage, when we were discussing the idea of monitors, it was said by someone, I can't remember who now, we might as well agree to this, it's going on anyway, it's being done covertly, why not just do it overtly? So there isn't strong resistance, I don't think, to monitoring. And that, I suggest, is the only idea I came up with as to how we might identify what is actually going wrong, if anything is going wrong. I've stated the view that there's ground for suspicion that there may be illegal hunting, but I couldn't make a finding on the basis of what was presented to me, and I did see a lot of film evidence. So it's getting someone behind the scenes that might produce a bit more material. And it might also, in my view, although that might be a formal role and might result in some monitor's report becoming evidence in a court, I didn't really envisage that at the beginning. I think what they would need to do at the outset is watch what was going on, and if in fact there was some anxiety in the mind of the monitor about the activity perhaps breaching the legislation, then discussion of that would be appropriate to try to resolve the issue and make sure it's done satisfactorily. And I was thinking that way because there are so many genuine people on both sides of the argument. And if it's possible, I would have thought most, unless they are so against the very act of hunting in principle, that most would want to find a way of accommodating the interests of both sides.
I offered to attend a hunt myself, and even in my limited ability to ride a horse, even join in. But I didn't get that invite. I understand you had. Did you have similar challenges to?
No, I did go to watch a hunt organised by the Duke of Buccleuch Hunt, but I wasn't on any vehicle other than a car to get along the road. I was able to observe it freely. I was with others who were observing. I mean, it's common practice for those who are perhaps beyond the age of participating actively or who have simply always just had an interest to go as observers. And we were able to go to the places they identified as the places to watch what was going on. And I'm slightly surprised you wouldn't have had your offer accepted. I think there's an anxiety on the part of those engaged in hunting, particularly you're talking about mounted hunting. Mm-hmm. There's anxiety on their part to appear to be as open as they can be, and I would think another request would probably be met with agreement.
And a few riding lessons maybe as well.
Well, no, if you can drive a quad bike, you'll be able to keep up.
Thank you.
Queer, because the proposal about observers would require people who are impartial but also knowledgeable. Are you confident that from within the two camps, if you like, you could secure a sufficient pool to carry out that role effectively?
My immediate thoughts, and this shows how institutionalised I am, my immediate thoughts would be along the lines of a former policeman or someone of that kind. Okay. And the police do have quite a number of officers, as you will see. You know, shortage of police involvement is not an issue here. So there's loads of police with experience. I wouldn't have thought it was difficult to find somebody. Okay. They also don't need to be riders involved, but would if the decision was to go down this road at all, even to think about it a bit further, it can be done in a quad bike, I think, in most places now. Okay. So I don't think it lacks feasibility. It's in the sense of being close to and involved in the activity. I think the difficulty is working out exactly what the role of that person is once the activity starts and how ultimately that person is going to convey the information gathered to those that have to ultimately to take the decisions.
Okay, that's fine. Mark, let's go.
Yeah, good morning.
Good morning.
Your report suggests that there are around 800 foxes killed every single year in Scotland, and that around one in five of those deaths are attributable to hunting with dogs. Has that changed? Have those figures changed since the Act was introduced?
I don't think these are the actual figure. There are thousands of foxes killed in Scotland by various means. There are roughly, I think, about, I thought it was still 800 roughly killed by mounted hunts and possibly a few less by the footpacks.
The figure was 20%.
Is there a part in the report you can direct?
Referencing 619 and also 3.8. It would be useful if you could clarify that, Lord Bonomy.
To the figures from one pack.
So it's implied that 20% are actually killed by dogs.
Yes, yeah, yeah. That's true. But that will be 20% probably of roughly 800. Mm-hmm. So
yeah, so 100.
The rest, and in fact, another 10% of these may well be killed by the terriers.
Yeah. So do you have
not killed by the terriers, but brought out by the terrier and then shot. So there's a significant percentage, yes, who are.
Yeah. So do you have a sense of how that proportion has changed? Because obviously the purpose of this bill was to prevent hunting with dogs. So has that changed? Has the bill actually been effective in reducing the number of foxes that are killed by dogs rather than guns?
I don't think I have that information. No, I don't think it's possible to say. Right. There's no information, at least I'm not aware of any information about the numbers killed by dogs before the legislation.
Okay. So if you haven't been able to come to an opinion on that, what's your opinion about the level of foxes that are killed by dogs and hunts at the moment? Is 20% acceptable? Is 160 foxes killed by dogs acceptable every year? Or is 50 acceptable, or 10, or zero? Given the intention of the Act, where do you draw the line?
What's missing in this, I think, is a comparison with the effectiveness of the foot packs and the extent to which dogs with those on foot actually kill the foxes. Now, I don't think I have any of that information.
And that's with guns, isn't it? That's flushing.
Yes, it's flushing to guns, but they inevitably have occasions when the fox is caught by the dog as well. You can't say that there will be 100% shot. The likelihood is that more are shot there because more guns are deployed. Yes. And that was the one thing that disturbed me about the difference in the practice.
Bonomy, can I just focus you on the issue, which is the intention of the Act, which is to ostensibly to outlaw the hunting of foxes using dogs as the method of killing the fox.
Yeah.
That was the purpose of the bill originally. So a 20% breach of that, if you've got 20% of the number of foxes that are being killed each year are actually being killed by dogs rather than guns, do you think that's acceptable, or what is the level at which you think that's acceptable given the original purpose of that Act?
I don't think that's a matter for me. That's a matter for those who have got to make political judgments. Sorry, it's not something I've got any views on at all.
Right.
Okay.
Sorry.
Okay. Yeah. Okay, and moving on, Claudia Beamish.
Thank you, Vena, and good morning to you, Lord Bonomy.
Morning.
Could I ask you a little more detail on the issues that we've begun to explore? How much does the practice of fox hunting carried out prior to the 2002 Act differ from the practice of pest control, and how does this differ from the practice of trail hunting used in England?
Well, trail hunting, if done properly, would be called drag hunting, I think.
Yeah.
And if it was done properly, would result in no foxes at all being killed or chased or killed by dogs. Flushing to guns is clearly different from what went on in Scotland before, because guns didn't normally accompany mounted hunts. Mm-hmm. So it's different. Where there is cause for concern is in the number of guns deployed and whether they are likely, in general, to achieve the objective I have views about the language, as you know, about when the fox is shot, but the objective of shooting a fox effectively as soon as possible. Now, that's where I think I see Mr. Russell's point from a legal perspective, that the question for me is how effective is flushing to guns? And it did strike me that deploying two, as is the protocol that the mounted hunts have, would generally speaking run the risk of the fox, once flushed, running and being chased. On the other hand, the foot packs with their 20 guns deployed or whatever are much more likely to reduce the chances of that. But the hunt I observed, I think there were either five or six guns, so two isn't the norm. I understand the norm with mounted hunts is higher. But I think there is scope for the fox to run in these circumstances. I didn't see enough of it to say just how regularly that might happen.
Right, thank you. And in your view, is the flushing of foxes with hounds needed generally or in specific areas to actually control the foxes?
I think that one's beyond my remit.
Okay. Okay.
I'm sorry.
So could I also just ask you, I'm going to ask anyway, but I'm not going to put words.
No, please do.
I'll ask anyway. It may well be beyond your remit as well. But in terms of the Scottish Government, as I understand it, have put forward that they'll look at the recommendations. There's been some concerns expressed that it would be helpful if the whole report was looked at. And there have been, I've got a comment, for instance, I'm trying not to use too much paper, so you'll bear with me.
Yeah.
That in paragraph 711, that Police Scotland's submission to your review was quoted as saying, exceptions to the offence to, quote, deliberately hunt a wild mammal with a dog are multiple and provide opportunities for exploitation by those who continually and deliberately offend. So with that evidence from Police Scotland, I do understand you're saying it was difficult in view of even all the film that you looked at and everything to see evidence, but I'm just wondering where those observations would sit in and the concerns expressed by Police Scotland and others if observations within the report are excluded.
I gave a lot of weight to the observations by Police Scotland. I was actually very surprised to get them in the form in which they came, bearing in mind the evidence that had previously been given to the committee. And I pursued that by interviewing the Assistant Chief Constable and also Mr. Scott. The problem, perhaps, is knowing whether all of these are references to mounted hunts. I mean, there's lots of urban crime around wildlife, which is just vandalism, and that it falls within the language used here. But the very end of the police submission, there is a statement about the legislation having become almost unworkable. Now, I don't subscribe to that view, but you can understand why getting that from the police made me concerned.
711 states, as a consequence of this lack of clarity, the police are on occasion unable to establish the high threshold of evidence required to prove and ultimately report cases. From the discussions that you had with Police Scotland, did you get a feel for the scale of the problem that this has created? Were the police able to sort of quantify for you or illustrate the type of issues they encountered?
Insofar as I was able to get a feel for it, I didn't think it was a large-scale problem. But I do think they are frustrated by the language of the legislation. And do feel that, and they themselves, I think, feel that it's difficult to be sure that something's going to be proved in a court because of the various requirements that exist. That they don't actually record the details of the decisions made about whether to proceed with a complaint or not proceed with it, and therefore I couldn't get anywhere on the volume of this. But it's the very fact that it's said by an assistant chief constable, for whom I think most people have a high regard, that makes you, you know, think twice about it. But then you hear the other side of the story and you have to try to strike a balance. In the end of the day, I thought that there was a clear basis for legislative revisal. Whether it will achieve the objective of making proof simpler, I'm not sure. I went further on that question when I suggested reversing the onus of proof, but that again is not a legal decision at the end, it's a political one.
Okay, thanks. Claudia, you've...
Yeah, thank you. Just one final follow-up question. Lord Bonomy, in the report, in paragraph 612, you state that, and I quote, the work of the footpacks has the appearance of diligent pest and predator control operation, whereas among mounted hunts, pest control can appear incidental to the primary objective of exercising horse and hounds. And I just wonder if you've got any comment on that in relation to the report. And again, these observations are coupled with the Police Scotland observations have caused some concern about whether the whole report, rather than only the recommendations, should possibly be considered.
Well, I never observed the footpacks in operation, but I was impressed by the descriptions given of the way in which they operated and the very fact that they took an hour to set up the guns and so on in inadequate positions. That was quite different from the fairly casual appearance of the start of the hunt, which is very much a social gathering. However, in the course of the hunt itself that I was observing, it was clear that there was a will to do the right thing, that what was happening was genuine flushing. There was a fox shot very early on in the exercise, but they move. It's the moving that creates the problem. So as you move through the countryside, there's a question mark over whether cover is now being driven to flush out a fox, or whether the fox is actually being chased. And the bigger the area you cover, the more chance there is that the fox is being chased. I got the impression that the footpacks very much concentrated on a particular identified problem and confined the area more, naturally because they can't travel so far. But I also see, as I've made clear, many benefits from the sporting activity, and it's how you maintain that, I think, without and protect the fox is the balance that has to be struck. So it does. I think I've actually said at one point that it didn't appear from the papers prior to the legislation that everyone knew this is how the sport would develop, that it would become a pest control service. But I gather from those involved that they always had that possibility in mind. It looked to me a bit like reaction to circumstances. Let's see how we can maintain our support and be consistent within the law at the same time. But apparently it was always envisaged. I don't know whether MSPs envisaged this happening or not. So there is genuine pest control. I've seen it actually work. But whether it's properly described overall as a pest control service rather than a pest control ancillary to sporting activity is a broader question.
Thank you.
Morris Golden.
Thank you, Convener. Lord Bonomy, the next question is around prevalence of hunts in Scotland.
Yes.
And in your report, you state that the 2002 Act has had little impact on the numbers engaged in the activities of either mounted hunts or footpacks. Do you think this is because fox hunting is a relatively inelastic activity in relation to tighter regulation?
Well, if I understand that question correctly, I think there may be substance in the notion that there is a hunting community that wants to remain alive because it's a very important element in parts of the country, as a social element in parts of the country. And therefore, there will be a degree of inelasticity in this so that change is going to be resisted. But that's quite different, I think, from saying that the law is going to be broken. So it's a problem that has to be tackled one way or another if you want to maintain the activity by finding an outlet for it. Mm-hmm. What I know of the English system of trail hunting is not a great deal, but enough to think that there are proven examples where genuine activity was not taking place and that the aim was to put the huntsmen and those engaged in following the hunt in the position of engaging in the hunt of a fox by accident, as it were. So it's not as simple as saying, let's change to that and that will keep the social element and the elements that we value. There is a provision in our own legislation which preserves the use of a dog for hunting with falconry, but it specifically says that's for sporting purposes. It wasn't beyond the wit of the drafters at the time to recognise that hunting with a bird of prey and assisted by dogs was a sporting activity that we were prepared to be prepared to recognise. But I haven't given any thought to. I don't think there is a ready way of adapting hunting foxes with dogs to that at all.
Thanks.
Mm-hmm. Finlay Carson. Lord Bonomy, my line of questions regarding the policing of the 2002 Act. In some quarters, the fact that no mounted packs have been successfully prosecuted to date leads to the conclusion the Act's not working or is difficult to enforce for the police or the courts. Are you content that the organisations and resources in place with the police are suitable to enforce the Act as it stands? And on the back of that, if the Act was amended in line with the recommendations in the review, would the current structures and resources be appropriate to police it?
I think the simple answer to that is yes. And there was no evidence tendered to me that there was a need for additional resources. They would be welcome, but you have to be proportionate about this. You have to bear in mind what this is all about at the end of the day and what the other challenges for our public services and police are. So I think yes.
So I suppose if you had the pathway from the observers that you envisage to report to the police if there was anything untoward and be aware of the kind of evidence base that would be required, that would make the process more successful?
I think so, but I still, yes, I think as long as there's someone in there to provide the evidence, if you don't have someone observing, then the problem will remain that you have several hurdles to overcome to essentially to prove a negative to succeed in one of these prosecutions. And of course, my own particular concern, it may be a bee in my bonnet, but I'm concerned about the word deliberately. That stems from the impression I had that it's seen as an extra hurdle because it's a word that very seldom appears in legislation.
Okay, thank you. Angus MacDonald.
Okay, thanks, Convener. Good morning, Lord Bonomy. We've already touched on the issue of a general lack of clarity. However, you've highlighted two other main weaknesses in the legislation in the report. You highlight words used frequently in the Act, such as to hunt and deliberately, as you've just mentioned. And as we've heard, you also highlight the issue of a police perception of a lack of clarity in the language of the Act. And you go on to state that the small number of prosecutions under the Act may be explained, at least in part, by the difficulties of interpretation presented to both the police and the prosecutors. So are you confident that addressing the clarity of expression in the Act would increase confidence amongst wildlife crime investigators and lead to more prosecutions? And is any other action needed to increase confidence?
Well, I think it would increase confidence, but I also think either observing, as we've discussed, so that there is the basic evidence, or alternatively, the shifting of the onus of proof onto the accused to show that he fell within one of the exceptions, that would raise the prospect of conviction. But the very fact that there are so few cases is a difficult one to work out. There are obviously not only six. There were only six cases that were actually reported for prosecution. So it's a very small number to draw any conclusions on.
Okay, thank you.
Can I ask on the same theme in 2.11 in your report? It says the time limit for bringing prosecutions under the Act should be extended. Could you expand on that? You're thinking behind it.
Yes, this really comes from the Procurator Fiscal Service. DNA now forms a part of investigation, and even in the most serious of cases in the High Court, resources are such that it's very difficult to get DNA reports in adequate time for these proceedings. And this type of thing would fall way down the list. So that's going to take time. And also, there appear to be cases which come to light later. Because the activity is taking place out of sight, it may take a while for information to emerge about something. And with a six-month time limit, it may be too late to do anything about it. And the third point made to me was that expert evidence about what is actually going on, observing the individual's actions, whether that amounted to hunting, is a common aspect of the investigation of these offences, and getting expert reports takes time. Now, because there already are provisions in other wildlife legislation for this, it seemed sensible to me that should apply in fox hunting. And I can't see the argument against it.
Okay, thank you. Continuing Angus MacDonald's theme around clarity of expression, on the monitoring section proposals for change, you make reference to, for years now, animal welfare activists have endeavoured to monitor the activities of mounted hunts. For various reasons, there have often been tensions between those engaging in hunting and the monitors, or saboteurs, as some are known. Well, of course, there's a difference between being a monitor and being a saboteur, even under the current situation. Where, for you, is the line crossed? Because it's one thing to monitor to ensure compliance with the law. It's another to seek to sabotage a legally conducted practice, however much you might disapprove of it. So I just wonder what your thinking would be around that.
Well, if you take, for example, the League Against Cruel Sports, who are probably most active in this field, they would never, as far as I can tell, be trying to disrupt an activity, but they would want to get as close as possible to recording what was going on. Other groups, which aren't all that different in the sense that they have animal welfare as their objective, call themselves hunt sabs or saboteurs. That's a badge of honour for them, and it is an achievement to cause some form of disruption. And it's generally peaceful protest, but just getting in the way, for example, that would be an act of sabotage in the end. It's a dangerous thing to do apart from anything else. So there are those who go a bit further, and actually are happy to be known by that badge. But there are organisations, responsible organisations, monitoring at the moment, but they're monitoring without the approval of those that they are monitoring. That's the big difference.
Okay, thank you.
Lark Roscoe.
Can you expand in a bit more detail on why you didn't recommend the restriction on the numbers of hounds that are used?
Well, the very fact that in England and Wales, they don't flush the guns suggested to me that it was impractical. And the evidence that existed, although it's controversial, there was some research evidence indicating that it clearly takes longer to flush foxes with two dogs than with a pack, which means that already there's an added element of tension within the chase at a very early stage. So I thought that, and I also didn't think that it was the number of dogs that was the problem. I don't see anything, I can't think of anything to suggest that somehow or other reducing it to two dogs would change the situation other than to bring the whole practice of flushing to guns to an end. So that change, I think, would mean the end of hunting as we see it at the moment.
Right. What, I mean, what are the views of stakeholders to that point of view in your report?
Who do you mean by stakeholders?
Those who've been involved in the process.
Well, there's a very large number of the submissions supported reducing the number of dogs to two. But these were largely assertions about how that would be a much more acceptable way of conducting the activity. I can't remember any detailed argument other than the argument between the scientists about the research they had done and the criticism of the research. There are two points of view about the research that's been done on the use of two dogs. And it was done fairly recently. It was done in about 2013, I think.
Okay. And we heard earlier on about the section in the report, I think it's 612, where you described pest control function of mounted hunts as being incidental to the need to get horses and hounds out for exercise and a social. Given that, would the reduction in the number of hounds actually have any impact on the pest control function of a mounted hunt? Was that a concern that you had?
It just wouldn't happen. I think going by the English experience, it would be seen as not viable to flush a fox to a gun with just two dogs. In the sort of cover we're talking about actually very large areas of cover. You're talking about woodland, and then when it gets out of the woodland, there's often very thick scrub as well, covering very large areas of the countryside. Mm-hmm.
But how does that impact on the intention to control foxes as a pest? Because if you're saying if mounted hunts are pretty incidental to controlling foxes anyway, Would there be any impact in terms of responsible fox control in the countryside if we did reduce the number of dogs that were associated with mounted hunts?
Probably marginal.
Probably marginal, okay. Right, okay.
Emma, do you want to come in now?
Kind of a wee follow-up. I mean, mounted hunts are obviously really important for social activity, social heritage, community in the countryside. And I'm aware of employment that's supported, saddlers, farriers, and other rural employment. So wouldn't it just be less contentious to promote drag hunting and then separate, the pest control from the sport? So essentially, promote drag hunting, ban fox hunting, and promote pest control at night, because that seems to be lamping, shooting a fox at night, using a lamp, bag six foxes, whereas a fox hunt ends maybe with a fox, maybe with a fox torn apart. So wouldn't it just be better to promote drag hunting and ban fox hunting?
Judging by the experience in England and Wales, I think the answer has to be no, because the number of prosecutions proportionately is more or less the same there. They're not well organised for prosecution in England. The Crown Prosecution Service don't do it all. It's divided up among different animal welfare organisations as well as them. So there's a lack of clear statistical information, but such as I could obtain from them indicates there's not much difference. And there's lots of apparent breaches of the legislation by inappropriate drag hunting, which is called, in fact, trail hunting. A different material is used so that it mimics the scent of a fox, and inevitably, in many instances where foxes are prevalent, a fox appears on the scene. So I wasn't convinced that just moving to that without other changes, or instead of other changes like monitoring, I wasn't convinced that that would make any difference.
My understanding was that drag hunting is fake scent.
It is.
Man scent.
So it is, but that's not what is done. I mean, drag hunting's an ancient activity, not done in Scotland, but has been done for a long time in England, Wales, before the legislation was passed. And therefore, that's where the idea comes from. But if you change what you're doing so that you're carrying it out in an area where there might be foxes, and you use the scent of fox urine, which you import from the United States, to create the trail, then there's scope for the accidental arrival of a fox on the scene. And that's what's given rise to a large number of, well, when you say large number of the prosecutions in England and Wales.
I guess when we're talking about pest control, we also have to see this in the context of many of the same people who would want to ban fox hunting would want to ban snaring, in which case, how do you carry out pest control of this nature?
Yeah, I think that's right. I mean, snaring, we've recently seen publicity about that as well. It's how it's done that's the issue. It's not the very fact that it's an essential element. In fact, most foxes are shot in Scotland of those that are killed, and that's thousands, as I said earlier, but there's still a significant number snared as well.
Yeah, okay. Finlay Castle wants to come in.
Vera, can I just clarify, were you suggesting that there's more chance of the aims of the Act being achieved through not banning fox hunting, and that there's actually more problems associated when only drag hunting is allowed?
Going by the English and Welsh experience, yes. But I've always got in my mind here the notion that this is an activity which has been conducted in this country for 300 or 400 years, and one that was seen as legitimate has most of the elements of which don't give rise to any problem. And I've always had in my mind the notion that perhaps there must be a way of preserving that and at the same time securing the welfare of the animal. And therefore, my views couched not by the idea of, or couched in the form of abolishing it, but trying to find a way of maintaining it.
Thank you. Let's move on and look at licensing and penalties. David Stewart.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Many in the animal welfare lobby have called for a licensing scheme. Clearly, you didn't recommend that in your report. Could you talk through the committee the pros and cons of the analysis you made before reaching that conclusion?
Well, I was influenced, I think, as I said, first of all, by the fact that the licensing provisions that were in the original bill were removed, and that seemed to be the feeling. But I wasn't entirely clear, and I didn't receive much in the way of submission to indicate what the benefits would be. And I can see the one obvious benefit I can see is that you can take away someone's license if he does something contrary to the, the conditions. So there's a benefit there. Mm. But you've still got to prove that he's done something contrary to the license. And the big issue for me here is how do you prove that people are infringing the law? Mm. And that difficulty, I thought, took a priority. I also saw a cost implication as well, which I didn't have any information on, but I could have considered the point in principle in a bit more detail, I concede, and left the cost benefit analysis to someone else later, but I wasn't convinced that there was an obvious benefit for any significant expenditure in having licensing. Mm.
So in the end of the day, it's down to the fundamental problem of proving what happened when.
That's what I see as the as the issue.
And, I mean, certainly you'd probably picked up from other evidence we've taken generally about animal welfare. It's a real difficult area, this. What goes on, what's the level? Level of prosecutions tend to be quite low. And I think you were suggesting earlier having what would be used in other terms, a professional witness on us to witness what goes on and to verify that to the police and to the courts.
Well, I think that decision may also depend to some extent on the value that those who have to make the decision place upon the activity. Mm. I mean, if it's an activity that's not worth saving, then monitors aren't worth spending money on. If it is worth trying to save the activity, then they are.
Right, thank you.
Alexander Burnett.
Thank you, Convener. Can I just note my register of interest around countryside management and agriculture? Lord Bonomy, at the risk of challenging a judge on his legal recommendations, I wonder if I pose a couple of questions around reversing the burden of proof and extending the time limit. In your discussion of reverse burden of proof, you seem to suggest the burden should only be reversed in cases where the burden can easily be discharged. I'm just wondering whether, you know, how you would see a defendant being able to provide evidence to show that a fox was flushed as soon as possible, and would you contend it's very subjective arguments, and would it result in people being open to malicious or vexatious prosecutions, many of whom would not have the resources to defend their innocence against a presumption of guilt?
I don't see a basis for thinking that there would be malicious prosecutions. I don't have the impression that that is a feature of of what goes on here. I accept that you might feel persecuted because somebody's filming your every activity, but filming in itself is a fairly open thing. To be clear about the reversing of the onus of proof, my own opinion is that the law as it stands at the moment reverses the onus of proof. But I'm probably in the minority in the legal profession in thinking so, and it hasn't been tested. In the one case that we did have, in Fraser against Adams, it could have been tested, and indeed at the appeal stage, the Crown considered doing so, but didn't. And I know that your own law officers probably disagree with me as well, in which case I see little chance of a prosecution being conducted on that basis, and therefore the recommendation was made. Now, I'm fairly sure that someone engaged in a hunt giving an account of what happened to support the idea or the claim that the fox was shot when it was safe to do so, which is the law at the moment, would have a good chance of being accepted. I don't think this is a situation that's peculiar. I've given many examples in here of how, in very technical areas where the reverse onus applies. The strongest argument against the reverse onus is that it tinkers with the notion of proof beyond reasonable doubt. Someone has to prove on a balance of probabilities that the defence is made out. They can, in these circumstances, end up convicted on evidence that is not proof beyond reasonable doubt. It's effectively a balance of probabilities that the defence isn't made out. And that is a very powerful argument in principle against reversing the onus. But bearing in mind what we're talking about here and the activity, it's not life and death. And it's a thing about which people have very strong views. I thought that that suggestion was worth making. And I don't make it lightly, but I think it's a way of redressing the balance. I think the balance is tilted against successful prosecution the way things are, just by the very nature of the activity.
And would you see with extending the time limit, though, that this could compound the possibilities of miscarriages of justice when you could be looking at having to the defendant having to produce proof, very subjective proof, 3 years after an event, and if there was no video evidence, you're talking about people's witness statements from on the ground, and that could result under wildlife crime in someone losing their freedom.
Right? Yeah, you're correct about that. It would work against the interests of, of accused people to extend the time limit in that situation.
So you would, as a sitting judge, you wouldn't be happy with that kind of case?
I would be happy with it in the overall context, but I see the argument against it. I think I am in the minority on this, but I do see your point that if you require the accused to prove something and you extend the length of time, if I had to choose between the two, I would go for the reverse onus of proof.
Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you. One of the other recommendations you made was around vicarious liability, which for many would have its merits, especially sat alongside the Land Reform Act provisions around a register of land ownership. But of course, there has been legal challenge mounted to vicarious liability in another sphere already. So how effective do you think it would be, how advantageous would it be to introduce this?
Well, what sphere are you referring to, Chairman?
Well, there has been a challenge to vicarious liability around, I think, a gamekeeping case where a gamekeeper was convicted.
Vicarious liability is the word, the language I've used because it's commonly used, but it's not actually vicarious liability. Vicarious liability is more the situation you've just described, where the employer is liable for the activities of the gamekeeper. Here we're talking about a third party being held liable for an individual's criminal activity. And that third party has simply allowed his or her land to be used for the activity, without the current requirement that you must knowingly allow it to be used in breach of the Act. That's going a long way. I entirely accept that. I would not be at all surprised if there's strong political antipathy to placing blame on a landlord who simply permits his ground to be used. However, I do think overall we are looking for a way of, and rightly looking for a way of, strengthening the law. And it's another cross-check. It's another hurdle that has to be overcome to make sure, or to be satisfied, to make sure that the activity is being done legally. And it would, I think, result in consideration being given by landowners to the reliability of those who are going to hunt over their ground. I suspect there's another technical issue here, and that is that many leases in the hunting areas require the tenant to allow his land to be the subject of access by the hunt. And that may make it impractical. Yeah. I can see that. But it is a potential hurdle, and it did have support as an idea.
Talking of issues that have support, 6.16 in your report, where you talk about the suspicion that exists from either side of this argument, you said, yet the experience of the review and the interaction observed and the limited occasions opponents have met during the review give cause for optimism that it should be possible to agree on a way of trying to verify whether the suspicion of illegal hunting is well-founded. Now, we've touched upon common ground around monitors, but are there any other areas of common ground that you identify where you think progress could genuinely be made here?
Well, unlike opponents in some areas, they are regularly actively in communication with each other, and they there's probably at least two separate interests represented behind me at the moment, and they were certainly talking when I came in this morning. I just thought there was, although when dealt with individually, their views are perhaps expressed more strongly than when they're in the company of their opponents. I found a very high degree of courtesy and consideration in all their communications with me and with each other. And I also was impressed by the Scottish Countryside Alliance attitude to police requirements, where and that made me think that a monitoring system might work without legislation, as long as the police were willing to participate in it, because it's their requirements that matter, and we need everyone to put their heads together on this. So that's the only practical one I can think of at the moment. I can't think of any other particular area, but you never know where talking might lead.
Okay.
You're always going to have the difficulty, though, of those who are so opposed in principle to hunting, that they will still, no matter what agreements reached, be looking for ways of justifying the call to ban it as an activity.
Yeah, which maybe moves us on nicely to the issue of the Scottish Government's response to your report. And I realise it's a slightly difficult question asking what you make of that response, but I'm going to ask it anyway. From the perspective of, given what the Scottish Government's indicated it will take on board, where do you think that will take us to if these measures are introduced? I mean, can you envisage a situation where we could get into a much better place around hunting?
I can't answer that because I don't have the response. Do you have the response handy? I mean, it was sent to me, but it's something I didn't look at in preparation for this.
Okay, I mean, essentially the government's going to invite key stakeholders to work together to develop the code of practice for hunts,
yeah,
and explore the suggestion of a monitoring scheme. And ministers are going to consult around vicarious liability, the reverse burden of proof, the extension of the time limit, and the removal of inconsistencies and improvement of definitions. So they have largely taken on board, they're indicated they're going to explore your recommendations.
Yes, I remember now. The first part is the most encouraging in my view. Work on a code of conduct, and they seem fairly committed to that. I wasn't so sure about the commitment to legislative changes, but considering them, I think will inevitably lead to these being addressed, and addressed hopefully by the right people. I mean, I don't claim to have the answer to these legislative problems, because I've found from past experience in doing work of a similar nature to this, that your parliamentary draftsmen have minds that don't work the same way as any of the minds around here, and do come up with solutions to problems which appear intractable at the outset. So that sounds to be a plan that's likely to be productive.
Okay. I'm looking around the table. Do members have any other questions? Is there anything you wish to add, Lord Bonomy?
I don't think so, no.
Okay.
I'm grateful for the opportunity of explaining myself. I hope it's clarified some things, at least.
And we're grateful for the opportunity to question you. I think it's been a very useful session. So can I thank you for attending?
Thank you
and,
very much.
And we'll move on to agenda item 3 in a moment.
Not
at all. Thank you.
on the agenda is for the committee to consider a negative instrument as listed in your papers, the Protection of Seals Designation of Hollow Sites Scotland Amendment Order 2017, SSI 2017/63. I refer members to the papers and I invite any comments. No comments? In that case, is the committee agreed that it's not wished to make any recommendations in relation to this instrument? Agreed? Okay, we are agreed. The fourth agenda item is for the committee to consider petition PE1615 by Logan Steele on behalf of the Scottish Raptor Group on a state-regulated licensing system for gamebird hunting in Scotland. I refer members to paper four. And I seek the views of members on the action they wish to take around the petition. If I can add to that, the options would include inviting the petitioner to give evidence to the committee, to invite oral evidence from a range of interested stakeholders, or to combine the above options into a single meeting so that the committee firstly takes evidence from the petitioner before hearing from a panel of interested stakeholders. Example would be the RSPB Scotland, Scottish Gamekeepers Association and Scottish Land and Estates. And the committee could then agree to any subsequent action. Any thoughts? Claudia Beamish.
Thank you, Convener. I mean, I'm keen on the third option that you highlighted, and with the possibility of the petitioner being able to come to the second to the panel, if the petitioner was given that choice and opportunity, but under for the person to choose to do that or not, in that it may help the committee's deliberations.
Okay, we have a proposal there. Anyone else, Mark Roscoe?
I'm happy to back that, convener, but I would also request that we invite SNH in to speak to their report on international comparisons of game bird licensing systems. I think that would be very useful, and I hope that our consideration of this petition also relates not just to issues around wildlife crime, but also looks at the totality of how game bird management systems are in place in Scotland, particularly the issue around Muirburn, which we've seen in the skies around the east coast of Scotland in the last few weeks, but indeed other environmental considerations as well.
Okay, and would you see SNH being part of the second panel?
I would leave that to your discretion, convener, about where they would fit in best, either as part of the second panel or indeed as a panel on their own.
Okay. Any other views? Angus MacDonald.
I would just concur with Mark Ruskell. I would certainly also be keen to hear SNH speak to the evidence that they've taken or that they've found with regard to operations in other countries.
Can I suggest that, given the pressure on our time with so much to deal with, that it might be sensible to include SNH in that second panel as we propose it, and thereafter we can take whatever decisions we wish to? Are we content with that approach? Okay, thank you for that. That's useful. The committee's first meeting after the Easter recess is expected to be on 18th April. As agreed earlier, we'll now move into private session. I ask that the public gallery be cleared as the public part of the meeting is closed, and we'll suspend for 5 minutes.